They wanted to support Israel. They're the chosen ones, you know. They're the chosen ones. Now, when I talk about Israel, when I talk about the Jews who say they're Jews that are not, or of the synagogue of Satan, as Jesus warned us about. But, you know, Jesus isn't politically correct these days, so we may not be able to listen. They don't want you to listen to what he warned you about. They don't want you to listen to what the Founding Fathers warned you about if you ever allow a private bank to issue your money. But, hey, we're going to support the Balfour Declaration. We're going to support the English who created the Rothschild colony you now know as Israel. And keep in mind that the best predictor of future behavior is past events. History is a great teacher, and the upcoming Operation America Spring, to be held on May 16th, 2004, stands as an example of why we need to pay attention to our history. Dave says, I've received quite a few requests from people who want me to endorse Operation America in the Spring by expressing the belief that all we need to do is to stand up to the tyranny, expose the tyranny, and the tyranny will run for cover. Sorry, folks. Don't work that way. When American protesters show up in D.C. on the 16th of May, the government will indeed run. They will run to retrieve their guns. This event, if carried out in the proposed fashion, will end very badly, for when the people rise up and aggressively oppose a governmental tyranny, the government will strike back, and this group will be ill prepared to handle the backlash. Colonel Riley has dubbed the event Operation American Spring, beginning of tyranny house cleaning, supposed to commence on May 16, 2014, but he was just too busy to come on here and tell you about it and talk about it here. Riley identifies three phases of the plan. The first phase, as many as 10 million patriots assemble in a peaceful, nonviolent manner and remain unarmed. The second phase, at least 1 million of the 10 million will stay in Washington, D.C. for as long as it takes to see Obama, Reid, McConnell, Boehner, Pelosi, and Holder removed from office. The movement does not state how they will accomplish the removal of these public officials. And the third phase, West, Cruz, Carson, Lee, DeMint, Paul Gowdy, Jordan will comprise a tribunal from which investigations will be launched and prefer charges against the guilty. Now, just how these investigations occur and by what executive authority will the findings and recommendations of any tribunal be carried out is not clear. There is no mention of how the guilty would be arrested, charged, tried, and how the sentence is to be executed. I'm a sucker for movements in which we galvanize the people in a unified fashion to oppose the tyranny engulfing the U.S. and the rest of the world. However, the movement would prove to be ineffective on its face as it aims too low. The suggested arrest only targets the minions of the various tyrannical attacks upon our liberties. If one wants to assure the minions of the various tyrannical attacks if one wants to initiate the Occupy and Occupy movement to 2014 version, it needs to begin in the city of London, or in Basel at least, begin with the Federal Reserve. I cannot see any way that this movement is not a prescription for disaster with regard to the participants and their welfare. This kind of movement has happened before, and it met with abject disaster. Operation American Spring is the modern day bonus army. Dave Hodges says, I will not endorse Operation American Spring. I will not rise to speak for the event, but rather I speak against the event. I would love to throw my support behind the event, however, this event is a bad idea, and in 1932, the 1932 treatment of the World War I Bonus Army stands as an historical example of why he feels the way he does. World War I veterans were promised bonus pay for their brave efforts in the war to end all wars. After the 1929 crash of the stock market and over 50% of the nation's banks failed from 1929 to 1930, money became scarce, and these veterans, who became known as the Bonus Army, demanded their bonuses from the government so they could make ends meet in these difficult times. In the summer of 1932, the World War I veterans marched on Washington, D.C. in much the same manner as Operation Spring Movement is proposing to do this coming weeks. For weeks, the Bonus Army camped out near the halls of Congress. On the last day of the summer session in Congress, President Hoover ordered the Army to clear the veterans out. Now, keep in mind that martial law was never declared, and the use of the military as a police force was absolutely illegal. However, this did not deter Douglas MacArthur, as he was determined to rid D.C. of the Bonus Army. The Army was also led by Eisenhower and Patton as they laid waste to the shanty towns that the veterans had constructed. Their temporary shelters were burned along with their possessions. The veterans were gassed just as they had been by the Germans in World War I. Members of the Bonus Army were poked with bayonets. Many were beaten. The Army and their leaders showed the veterans little mercy. Subsequently, the veterans were driven from Washington, D.C., and they were never paid what they were owed. In actuality, the government, in one regard, showed the World War I veterans mercy by not mass murdering them. I question whether such a movement would not be met with more divisive force were this event to occur today. Now, on this side, there's a 6-minute clip which accurately tells the story of the Bonus Army. And these clips, let's see if we can find that, and see if we can get it where you can actually hear it. I actually may be able to do this. How are we doing?
In 1932, Washington was under siege. The capital was surrounded by over 10,000 unemployed veterans of World War I from all over the country. Their only assets were the bonus certificates they'd been given after the war, which promised a cash bonus sometime in the future. They needed it now.
At the end of May 1932, nearly 10,000 bonus marchers occupied the nation's capital, and tens of thousands more were on their way.
I'm going to get my bonus, and I'm going to wait until I get it. I have to wait until 1945.
What's that brought you to Washington?
I want to beat the Undertaker, spend the money before the Undertaker gets it.
I know who's made this country worth living in. It's just you fellas. Look. Makes me so damn mad a whole lot of people speak of you as tramps. By God, they didn't speak of you as tramps in 1917 and 18. No. Take it from me. This is the greatest demonstration of Americanism we've ever had. Pure Americanism.
President Hoover was left to deal with the veterans when the Senate rejected their demands. The marchers had stayed, camped out in central Washington.
On July 16th, the last day Congress was in session, Washington was on edge. Thousands of angry veterans surrounded the Capitol. Near midnight, the 72nd Congress adjourned. Congressmen left through back doors and underground tunnels to avoid confrontations. The situation had come to a head. The president ordered the evacuation of the veterans from downtown Washington.
Now you bring in the troops.
When MacArthur moved his troops to the affected area, he knew exactly what he was going to do. And he adorned himself in his dress uniform along with his major aide, Dwight D. Eisenhower.
The force stepped off at 4:30 p.m. More than 200 cavalrymen spread out across Constitution and Pennsylvania avenues. Behind them came 400 infantrymen, followed up by tanks and armored vehicles.
The cavalrymen, one of whom is Major Patton, have got their sabers out.
The soldiers donned gas masks and without warning began hurling gas grenades at the veterans. The troops advanced, some jabbing with bayonets.
It's war, the greatest concentration of fighting troops in Washington since 1865.
I knew something was going to happen, that we might be attacked. And I had a press card, so I passed the police lines, and then I saw the soldiers advancing into the camp. And when confronted with this, the men all stood there, said, "Stand firm as long as you can." And they started throwing tear gas.
Tear gas was just burning my face. I was trailing behind my dad, and he kept hollering, "Come on, boy, come on, boy."
Marchers were choking from the gas, just like the battlefields in France.
And so they're being forced out of their shacks by smoke bombs and tear gas hurled by the troops who have been called out by the President of the United States.
I've never seen anything like it. They systematically went down the line, burned up all the tents and all the possessions of the people there. I was thinking of Herbert Hoover when this happened, because his election was in 3 months. I thought this would be the finish of Hoover.
The orders of the president must be obeyed. And the roaring flames sound the death knell to the fantastic bonus army. In the shadow of the beautiful dome of the capital of the United States of America.
The veterans did not believe the country for which they had fought would ignore the plight into which the Depression had placed them. Many did not believe that United States troops would take the field against them.
By early evening, most of the marchers had been driven across a drawbridge that led to their main camp.
The president does not want MacArthur to cross the bridge, and MacArthur disregards the order. Eisenhower later says that he saw this happen, MacArthur says, I cannot bother with pieces of paper during a military operation. And so he crosses the bridge.
All through the camp were scenes of panic.
My dad says, let's get the hell out of here. The soldiers are going to kill us.
Then troops began to set fire to their wooden shacks. One reporter wrote, the blaze was so big it lit the whole sky. A nightmare come to life. The president looked out a window of the White House in the direction of the fire, then retired for the night.
And the roaring flames sound the death knell to the fantastic Bonus Army that ends so disastrously in the shadow of the capital of the United States of America.
The morning after the Bonus rout, public sentiment took a dramatic turn against Herbert Hoover. If the expulsion needed a human face, it came in the person of Joe Angelo, whose story was published across the nation.
Joe Angelo gets the Distinguished Service Cross for saving Patton's life on the battlefield. The next morning, Angelo comes to the burned-out field to see Patton. And Patton says, take this man away. I don't want to see this man.
The BEF was broken up. The men returned to some city or other, there to roam the streets, hopelessly seeking work or to shuffle in breadlines. There they remain, crying examples not of the need for the Bonus, but of the need for a new American system.
Now, when those future heroes of World War II suppressed the Bonus Army, they were operating outside the scope of law. The Army of 1932 could not rely on the NDAA, the martial law legislation that Americans are living under today did not exist in 1932. Many of the modern-day martial law provisions are game changers. The minions of the globalists would like for nothing better than to draw a large number of dissident Americans out into the open and smash them like a bug on a windshield. This would send a clear message to every other American that resistance is futile. One organizing principle of warfare is based upon the notion of not challenging the enemy where they are strong. If millions of Americans, and I doubt that very many people, would be brought to D.C., were to be opposed and crushed, they would have played into the strength of our enemies. Our efforts are better spent engaging in organized activities where we can have a real impact without the forces of the New World Order being able to openly oppose us under the color of law in order to crush our movement. Operation America Spring also has the potential to erupt into civil disobedience and provide our enemies with the ability to begin mass arrest of American citizens in the name of restoring order. This event could prove to be the beginning of the Internet resettlement movement, which Dave Hodges wrote about in this past week, the internment resettlement. And remember, I have told you that in South Carolina, for instance, they've made it illegal to be homeless. You're on the street, or you're wandering around Washington, D.C., you don't have a job here. Woo! We'd send you to South Carolina. They're one of those FEMA camps there. There will come a time to openly oppose the emperor's forces. However, this open opposition to tyranny will not successfully come from the people. Open opposition will come from the military led by the fired generals who were shown the door by Obama. Mark my words, that day is coming, but instead of coming from a Bonus Army, it will come from a guerrilla force of veterans which will lay waste to the oppressors. The people can fight, strike back effectively. Dave Hodges says, I am not proposing that the people do not strike back and that we just lay down and take our beating without putting up any resistance. However, the people need to oppose tyranny with an expectation of success. Taking back our government need not involve the needless creation of martyrs. Dave Hodges says, recently I received a message from a couple living in Panama City. While shopping in their local Walmart, they encountered abuse at the hands of Walmart's new security force, who call themselves Securitas Security, or SS for short. This couple, without provocation, were falsely imprisoned, had battery committed against the husband, and their property taken by Walmart stormtroopers. Now, many of us know that Walmart engages in virtual slave labor in China. We know that they were previously caught lying about their products being made in America. We know that former DHS security, Janet Napolitano, kicked off her See Something, Say Something East German Stasi spy program at Walmart. And many of us are aware that Walmart will be used in detention centers in the upcoming martial law. So why would anyone shop at a Walmart? Of course, you might save a few pennies by buying products produced by slave labor, but at what cost to humanity? Attention, Walmart shoppers. You are funding tyranny. Beyond Walmart, Kmart, and all the other slave marts controlled by the globalists, In this battleground, the people hold the power. A real Operation American Spring. The American people do not need an American Spring. We can silently oppose the New World Order by withdrawing our support. Take your money, except for enough to pay your bills, out of the Federal Reserve controlled banks. Educate yourself and take advantage of the tax deductions offered under the tax code so that you can stop feeding the collection arm of the Federal Reserve, the IRS. Begin to grow as much of your own food as you can and stop shopping in the Big Ag grocery store, which force feed us GMOs. Do not eat out at the corporate restaurants. Eat at the mom-and-pop restaurants. Stop feeding the beast. Again, folks, what have I told you? Grow your own food. Generate your own energy. If you do that, you don't need them for anything, and they don't get support for you. There may be an armed confrontation in our future, but it will not be successfully initiated by you or any Operation American Spring type of movement, as all you are doing is risking your own demise for an endeavor that has no hope of succeeding. Strike at the root and take away money from humanity's enslavers. There will come a time to oppose tyranny because they are not going to acquiesce to the will of the people. But, as Dave Hodges says, he has pointed out, this will not be a people's opposition movement initially. The military will have to spearhead the movement. For now, we are all the resistance, but our resistance is that of an economic guerrilla fighter. Hit these people where it hurts in the pocketbook and keep yourself safe in the near term and stay away from Washington, D.C. on May 16th, 2014. And they worship the dragon which gave power unto the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, Who is likened to the beast, and who is able to make war against it? I believe in order for the common man to thrive, we must stop playing the globalist games at all events, on all levels. We must withdraw our support from the beast. Let's focus on what we can do. Once again, we know the globalist game. We know where they are vulnerable. We know where their strength lies. If they can control the weather, they can control whether you live or die initially, literally. They have already killed millions of people with weather modification. Most of all, we need to, we must stay away from the streets and rioting until we have a majority with us. They are well prepared for us. We need to build our own system of trade and barter, food production, water storage, energy, etc., to counteract what they are doing. It's what, again, I've told you folks over and over again, we need to put, we don't need Chinese solar farms put on public lands. We need solar, wind, magnetic generators put on our homes. Make your homes the source of your power. That's right. How are we doing here? Still upload stuff. All right. 9:41. Yeah, I'm just, guys, here's your comments from Dave's article. You got Bob saying, just another coward slowing down the revolution. Only 3% wanted America to be free from the Brits. Join the 97% of cowards happy to do nothing but make pathetic and weak suggestions on the internet. Crawl back into your mom's basement, coward. Yeah, I saw the same thing happen with at the Bundy Ranch. There were people who were saying, well, that's our money, that's my land, this is our, I'm part of the public, that's my land, that's he's just not paying his fair share. He didn't want to pay for that grass that his cows ate. We need to charge him for that grass that the cows ate. Well, we haven't been doing that for 2,000 years. Why would we start now? Got me, folks. You're going to find somebody that is just going to be counterproductive. And somebody else said, the movement should therefore use guerrilla tactics. Amass your 10 million, but use the exercise to teach them how not to shop with the beast. I wanted to go. I would like to go to Washington. I'd like to be there to be the voice of reason. You know, somebody said, well, they're going to use that for a false flag. They're going to do that. They're going to attack. They're going to do what they did to... They're going to do what they... Well, that's... They're going to do what they did, what they always do. That's what they always do. They always have their plans. Then they've got the tanks sitting back there, and they got the 50 caliber bullets. And they want you to fire the first shot. I've always had a maxim. I guess you'd say, I don't throw the first punch. You want to fight with me? Take a swing. Take a swing. And then I'll put you in the hospital, and then we'll get on to business. I've got a guest coming on tomorrow, and I'm going to give you a little, this is somebody I've known for a lot of years. Name's, Russell Pavilardo. Let's see what he's got to say.
Blog Talk Radio.
You heard him, folks. That was Louis Armstrong singing Wonderful World. I'd love to know what he was smoking. Wow, I could smell it now. It must have been an early 70s crop. Great stuff back then. Sure wish I had some now. Wonderful World, my ass. This world is an unholy hell and getting worse. A large cage, a mental institution, where the inmates have taken full control. Damn, you have to fight just to stay alive. And if you want to thrive and not just survive, you had better fight to win by any means necessary on prison planet Earth. And on this show, which will be on every Wednesday night here on The Phoenix, with the assistance of my sidekick, Tammy Texas from the Lone Star State, is going to show you that once upon a time, in an age long past, when humans had no fear of death, no religion, no government, no rules, no power hungry leaders, this planet was not as it is today. In other words, mankind was free. And what's more, I, the Phoenix, is going to tell you what you must do to get back to that peaceful, turbulent, free state. No, it won't be easy. But never forget that one man or woman with courage makes a majority. And when heart, mind, and the power of will are set to purpose, nothing is impossible. Yes, my friends, the world has changed. I can smell it in the polluted air, a toxic atmosphere filled with poisons, chemtrails, contrails, and other assorted pollutants. I can taste it in the fluoridated water, even in the bottled water, the water that you pay for at the supermarket. Fluoride, a rat poison, used in the manufacture of the atomic bomb, and then put into your toothpaste in the 1950s by Colgate to give you dental fluorosis and tooth decay. Any of you out there remember those 1950 toothpaste commercials? Well, if you did, what you never knew, and I bet on it, is that old Mr. Tooth Decay in those 50s commercials was, in fact, Uncle Sam in disguise. But allow me to continue. Not that I need your permission. Fluoride is a major ingredient in a drug called Prozac, used to sedate you, putting you in a mental state of lethargy, making you apathetic or indifferent to all that is really going on around you. And if you, my friends, are of sound mind, if you're really awake and aware unlike the American masses who walk around acting like zombies, sheep, cattle, with their eyes open wide, but open wide shut. You would be able to connect the dots. The chemtrails, the contrails, gun control, false flag terror, the Patriot Act, the wars for profit, the Israeli lobby, the passage of unconstitutional laws, executive actions by the puppets in the White House and the lame duck congressmen, the FEMA camps, detention camps, prisons, sprouting up all over the old USA, now the new states of Israel, the FEMA coffins depicted in the murals that line the walls of Denver International Airport, the Georgia Guidestones. If you could connect those dots, you would see, as I do, the coming enslavement of the races of man. After, of course, the population is cut down to 500 million, as written in the stone carvings in the Georgia Guidestones, just outside of Atlanta. Friends, I have only just begun. Let's take a few steps downwards and go deeper into the proverbial rabbit hole, for the taste gets more and more bitter. I can taste the POPS, the persistent organic pesticides, the chemicals or excitotoxins in the soft drinks, such as aspartame, Splenda, which is aspartame on steroids, and who knows what else. And I could taste it in the genetically modified foods, foods that are hazardous to your physical as well as your mental health. But most of all, I can see it in the attitude of the mind control masses, the American sheeple, the stupipedes, the robo-sapiens, the collective hive. Yes, I can see it in a dumbing down of America. You, my friends, have been taken, had, hoodwinked, and bamboozled, run amok and led astray by the Zionist-owned and controlled media. Do you know that the Jews own 96% of the total world media? And the mainstream media that the Jews own is the fifth column of the United States Armed Forces, who fight not for your freedom, but to take away the freedom of other peoples. How about the television set invented by Edward Bernays, known as the father of propaganda? Google it. The programs? It is you who are being programmed. The result? A mind-controlled citizenry who would believe anything they are told to believe. A nation of slaves who erroneously believe that they are free. Again, go to Google or YouTube, or go to any major library in any major city and do your homework. Do your own research. Trust no one. Believe no one. Not even me, the mighty Phoenix, who would never lie to you. Verify my words of truth. Verify my words of wisdom. Look into fluoride, excitotoxins, chemtrails, the effects of HARP, H-A-A-R-P energy on the brain. Look up the effects of TV on the brain, television, and mind control and brain damage to the cerebral cortex of the brain. And I promise you that everything you hear on this show is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And I will prove to you over the ensuing weeks who it is that wants you controlled, dumbed down, and enslaved. Yeah, who it is that is the world's foremost problem, as Henry Ford called it in 1906. You're going to learn who is the cause, the root cause of these insidious happenings. Who engineered this agenda? Who controls this cabal, this coterie, this den of vipers, who call themselves the elders of Zion, the lords of the Ashkenazi, the American and European Jews? Yes, Tolkien, shadow of the East, Eastern Europe is now upon you, and the barbarians are inside the gates.
That was a great beginning.
I thank you, Tammy. I hear you, Tammy. I hear you very well.